Because, as I say, the Garden City would be different from all the prayer for the settlements of the text. It wouldn't just be a refuge for the rich. It wouldn't just be open friends, a place for the poor and relegated. It would be a real city that would have, that would give all of the human population access to the new and the way of life. It would be a city of opportunity. Not only would it be mixed income, as we would say today, but also mixed use. It would include, ample employment opportunities. It would include places to shop. It would have easy access to the unspoiled countryside around it. Today we talked about walkability. Howard was Mr. Walkability in terms of creating this new town, in terms of creating this new town, this city. And he was fortunate enough to find collaborators who understood and really deepened his sense of methods, the basis of which was was also obsessed and upset with the dense load of growth of most English cities, who was able to receive with his partner, Bastian Parker, a real architecture of cooperation, a landscape of cooperation. Behind this landscape, lay the possibilities that came out of lower land forests, as well as the fact that Howard invented the idea that Lee mentioned just before, that the growth, or the growth of land values would not go to a few speculators and so on, it would go back to the community, for community facilities, to support affordable housing, to create this landscape of cooperation. Was essentially formed in the railroad year, where you have, the railroad provided this wonderful breadth of both dispersing population and then concentrating it around the state. Because basically, you have to live within walking distance. The problem is this: the Mahatma Ford, with the start of the automobile, disorganized the metropolitan region under these different principles. This is Ford's original Model T from 1908. It's amazing what came out of that mystery. But like everything, to be one of the fascinating parts of the history of modern cities do come is that the first people who really had to deal with this new era of mass automobility were not in England, but in the United States. And it was this remarkable group of planners, organized during something called the Region Planning Association of America, who were the first to try to come to grips with the automobile, the economic tactics, to Howard's Garden City, in the railroad area, whether you had a garden city or not, is that the people necessarily clustered around the railroad site, as you see here. But with the order of the end, that there needs to be room to be within walking distance of the site. As early as the 1920s, speculators in the measuring of other places outside of the big American cities started to lay out these vast routes for a drive for speculative houses. You see, the beginnings here of the school that would eventually overtake all of these monuments from the So this principle of dispersion outside the city, but concentration around the garden city of Newtown was being changed directly and the designers of the RPA responded, I think, in ways that still They picked up the onions concept of substituting for the old methods with what we learned to call the supermarket. And again, the scientists are incorporating the land of city by eliminating what is seen as unnecessary streets into being used as a community resource. Reinterpretation of the supermarket, in which you wanted to get the houses away from the busy water field. And so you locate them on these cul-de-sacs, reaching into the heart of the supermarket. But again, with the center of the supermarket saved for cooperative use. Instead of emphasizing the house, the individual house on the large lot, they took the houses of the average cul-de-sac and made a small lot and used the land that they saved for these communal park spaces. That is still one of the features of Radford. They emphasized and took up this idea of the landscape of cooperation, but of course, when completely against the process that took place in the United States actually finding this mind. The problem was, there was simply nothing to do with American real estate practice, American legal practice, no basis, really, no way of discipline, no way of keeping this town within the boundaries of the plan of success. That's for one of the great American traditions. Is real estate speculation. Immediately when you build a town in the center, then the price of the farmland around it went up. In other words, the idea that this careful orchestration of concentration, density, and open space around it simply had no legal basis, no policy basis behind it. So when suburbanization, mass suburbanization did come to the United States, it took this time rather different. So, one of the interesting issues that the cul-de-sacs remain a little bit different. But if you look at the typical way in which the American suburb in effect, the idea of a simple book remains. This is an area north of Detroit, what you're looking at are the grid of roads that goes back to the agricultural grid that goes back to Thomas Jefferson in the early 19th century. The form is a kind of spontaneous super block grid that there is more subdivisions essentially built off the edges of the super block here. Essentially, as this ground is in this cul de sac, and it's like into the field. In a sense, it is a fulfillment, but it is a partial fulfillment of this order. The problem with it was that in the African, this form was drawn to the very careful system, of pedestrian roads that got in out of the original super block. The way it was built out in the United States, it was the street of roads formed what are called collector streets. These collector streets, this is the cul-de-sac within the super block, is a beautiful sensation model. But when you get out to the collector streets, it looks something like this. For the child or even an adult, of course. So basically, you're trapped in the super block. The way the super blocks have been collected streets, the or perhaps not. One of the most amazing things to me is that I for the last 30, 40 years, it just went over the moon itself, seemed to be lost in the United States. There has been a remarkable return to the American city, reopening, justification, a reopening version. This is one of the best examples of the pro-education for the important world. With the recovery of Rio, there's also finding the recovery of something like the power of unlimited idea of concentrated development related to a world. This is the conference of the Asia to expand the world into development. A new port and a new goal for things the idea of the world is proving to be ahead of us as much as it is, as much as behind us. Here is the system and the hope for Portland as again a higher style metropolitan group. I just wanted to conclude with one tangent that I think shows the possibilities of this new age of American urbanism and perhaps world urbanism. This was in 2011, the Museum Minority created an exhibition of new kinds of suburban development for Portland. The most remarkable of those, in my opinion, was done to work in a city that would have been what we call ancient city, very much a church. And it's not really to update the concept of the modern city to see a really typical American suburbanization. The region is actually at a higher density than the typical school or suburb of America. It's being integrated in a new way, a growing city of a new color. It's very much change oriented, as I say, this project. But then all of these different housing topologies are not fixed. They are all things that could be built today. The one that got most people's attention was what I call a compost hill. These are the ground that put it on top of this fancy to raise the fuel prices in your life. You have to find a cycle of faith and faith. Thank you.